Good morning, Dean Hill. Good morning. We stand before you to bring your devotion. We ask that each and every one of you all join and participate. Amen.
Amen.
As we stand to prepare to read our affirmation of faith, if you will, get your Bibles and turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. The affirmation of faith reads as follows. I believe in God, the maker in heaven and earth, the ruler and preserver of our lives. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, my Lord and Savior. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who is the giver of life. I believe in the Bible, the universal church, holy baptism, and the Lord's Supper. I believe in the resurrection of the dead, in life, and the world to come. Scripture reading will be coming from Hebrews chapter 11, starting with verse 1. When you have it, say amen. If you don't, then wait a minute. Amen. It reads as following. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Verse 4, by faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gift, and by it being dead, yet speaketh. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found, because God has translated to him. Before his translation, he had his testimony that he pleased God. Verse 6, but without faith, it is impossible to please God. I'm going to say that again. It says, but without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I got a question for you this morning, Dean Hill. Are you believing God for anything this morning? Amen. I would just like to say, so many times we as people, we like to see it before we believe it. But how many of y'all are going to believe? You're going to believe it before you see it. Amen. And when the manifestation comes, guess what I want y'all to do? Tell somebody. Why don't you look at your neighbor and say, God is working on me.
God is working on me.
Look to the other neighbor and tell them, God is not through with me. Tell them, I'm a work in progress. I'm still finished. Unfinished business with God. Amen. Amen. So why don't you just join in with us as Evelina Dupre. Amen.
You may have a seat. Glory to God. This is the faith. Got to believe in our God. If you don't mind this morning, I just want to go to our Heavenly Father. Because I got problems, and I think some of y'all may have some too. So I want to stand here in the gap for anybody that's too ashamed to even say that they got a problem. Because I know a problem solver.
All right.
Woo, I know a problem solver. So can we go in prayer right now? All eyes closed, heads are back. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, because we know no other God to call on but thee and thee alone. Lord, you've been more than good to all of us, Lord. You've been a father to us that we do not even deserve, Lord God. But right now, your children are crying out to you, Lord. We need you in every way that a person could be that needs. We need you in every situation, in emotional situations, Lord, in financial situations, Lord, in mental situations, Lord. Lord, we lift up our children before you right now. Anybody that has a child, I don't care if it's a newborn, I don't care if it's a 50-year-old. Lord, we need you right now to touch our children right now, Lord God. Have your way with our children, Lord God. Touch their minds, this young generation, Lord. This young generation, I lay them at the altar right now, Lord. Because I see some of them where they want to skip steps in life, Lord, and do what other people are doing, but they haven't even did what you have called them to do. Just be who they are. Lord, I just ask that you touch right now. Touch mindsets, Lord God. I ask that you touch the sick. Somebody is sick emotionally, Lord. Somebody is sick mentally, Lord God. Somebody sick in their body and don't even know it, Lord. Somebody sick in their body and do know it and don't even care, Lord. I ask that you touch right now, Lord. Heal right now, Lord. Keep right now, Lord God. We need you here at Dean Hill, Lord God. We ask that you just have your way with each and every one of us, Lord God. We cannot do anything without you, Lord. Your word says if we abide in you, that you will abide in us, Lord God. And I know that to be true, Lord, because I tried to put myself, Lord God. And I see how that you treat me, Lord God. When I finally submitted to thy will, Lord God, I see how you keep on blessing me. In spite of me, Lord, you bless me anyway. And I tell you, thank you right now. We all stand and lift up our hands in the need of forgiveness right now, Lord. Lord, we just tell you, thank you right now for what you've already done, for what you're doing right now and what you're going to do, Lord God. We pray that you continue to bless with traveling grace with loved ones on vacation, Lord. We pray that you continue to bless the ones that look at seeking a job, that need a job, Lord God. Bless. But, Lord, I cannot just stop with my young people, Lord. They're battling, Lord, with this world, with this social media world. With this world, or you can do whatever and be whatever you. No, you cannot be whatever. You be whatever the Lord says you are. If he said you a young man, you act like a young man. If you a young woman, you act like a young woman. You act like a Christian if you say that you know the Lord. Because none of this gonna work. None of your ways will work. But when we abide in you, Lord. But when we abide in you, Jesus. But when we keep you first, Jesus. Do whatever you want to do, but put God first. Yay. And he'll line up. He'll start lining up things in your life.
Yes, he will.
He'll move stumbling blocks. Yes, he will. He'll forgive sins.
Yes, he will.
Yes, he will. Each life for Christ. I thank you right now, Lord, for what you're doing right now, Lord, in this house, Lord. Bless every soul under the sound of my voice, Lord, because we need you. We cannot get along without you, Lord. I just want to tell you, thank you right now. For all of us being able to step out on faith. Yeah. Just take that one step on faith.
My.
It's impossible to please you without faith. That's what your word just told us. And I thank you right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We thank you, Father God, forever and always. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God this morning, Dean, here. We serve an awesome God, and he is worthy to be praised. There's none like the God that we serve. Nobody. Mama may love you, but mama don't love you like God love you. You know what? Your daddy may love you, but daddy can't love you like God love you. Your sisters and your brothers or your husband or your wife, they may love you, but they can't love you like God love you. There's no one like the God that we serve. It's good for us to get together and sing praises to God. The Bible commands us to sing. The Bible tells us we should sing praises unto God because he's worthy to be praised. There's a lot of singing that go on in the world. A lot of singing, a lot of songs that come out that ain't necessarily about God. Some songs that I hear, though, I can't help but to think about God when I hear them, especially a lot of love songs. Alicia Keys put out a song years ago, and it said, some people want it all, but I don't want nothing at all. If it ain't you, baby, if I can't have you, baby, and with me being a Christian, I've heard that song a whole lot. And every single time I hear that song, I say, I know that she may be talking about a man, but that song right there sounds like what I should be saying to God. Some people want it all, but I don't want nothing at all. If it ain't you, Jesus, if I ain't got you, Jesus, because it's nobody like the God that we serve. No one else gets the glory. No one else gets the praise. We serve an awesome God. I don't know how you're feeling this morning, but no matter how you're feeling, God is still worthy to be praised. I got a question this morning. I'm going to sit down. I got a question for everybody this morning. Who are you clinging to? When we was in the back, Pastor, as he was praying, he said a phrase that made me think about a song, and it's called Cling to You. It says, Lord, it may get better, but it may not. But when I pray, God, I pray that I will trust you, whether or not the pain stops. So when the pain falls, coming down like raindrops, I just got to cling to you. I want to encourage you this morning, whatever you're going through, as long as you're clinging to the right person, as long as you're clinging through something that's steady, you're going to be all right. I remember seeing pictures of people falling into a river, and the river is flowing, and there's a current, and people thinking they're going to go under, but sometimes it's just this one piece of log sticking out, and this one tree that's sticking out, and they hang on to that tree, and they know that they're safe because that tree is steady. I want to say to you, I know somebody who is steady. No matter what you're going through, cling to Jesus. Do you trust him this morning? I went to a fireworks show this past weekend, and I saw a young lady walking, and she had like a child on her neck around 2 years old. And she was taller than me. The child was just on her neck, and they walking, you know, down the middle of the street. And I said, look at that, Patrice. And I hold Ryan, but I don't trust my son. I put my son on my neck, but I don't trust him to enough to let him ride on my neck without me holding on to him also. And I said to my wife, I said, look at that. She's not even holding that boy. He ain't going nowhere. And you know why? Because he trusted his mama. He was clinging to his mama. I want to say to you, no matter how bad it gets, make sure again that you trust in Jesus. Make sure that you understand that he got you in his hands. And as long as you're clinging to him, everything gonna be all right. We serve an awesome God this morning. He is worthy to be praised. It's good to see all of you here this morning. I thank God for our choir leading us in worship this morning. They said, give glory to God, saints. Give glory to God. Then they told us there's none like the God that we serve. Do we have any visitors here with us this morning? If we do have any visitors here worshiping with us, we're not going to try to sell you anything. We're not going to try to put you on the spot too much, but we would like for you to stand up just so we can see who you are and we can meet you and we can greet you and show you some love. If we don't have any visitors, then that's okay too. or if we do have some visitors who don't want to stand. At this time, what we're going to do, we're going to meet and we're going to greet each other, and we're going to stand up and love on one another. Our musicians, our wonderful musicians, are going to give us some music, and at this time, show your brothers and sisters some love in Christ. Do we serve an awesome God this morning? Somebody said, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. If the Lord has done something for you, if he's given something to you, then we ought to be willing to give something back to him. Good morning. We're going to meet and greet each other this morning.
Thank you.
You said in your word that you will, Jesus. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and give the Lord one more hand clap of praise in this place. There's a well-known talk show host who begins almost every show, or at some point during every show, she always says this, "Can we talk? Can we talk?" That's a famous saying, but I believe that on Sunday mornings when it's time for a sermon, God is speaking to his people and saying, "Can we talk? Can we talk?" I want to ask you a question this morning as we prepare to go for the message. How are you walking today? How's your walk? Are you walking under the influence and power of the Holy Spirit? Because the only way this Christian life is to be lived is to be lived in the Spirit. We don't live by information. We don't live by flesh. We don't live by intellect. You are a spirit being, and you are to be led by the Spirit. For the last few weeks, we have taught on the Christian home, and we've taught on the Christian marriage. We've talked about the role of the husband in the relationship, the role of the wife in the relationship. We've talked about the role of the children in the relationship. We've talked about the marriage and the family and the home as a whole. But now what I need to do is back up and tell you why it don't work for you. It works. It just may not work for you. And the reason why it may not work for you is because these things can only be done if you are walking in the Spirit. The whole context of the Christian home and the Christian family is for people that are willing to yield themselves to the Spirit of God and to walk in the Spirit. And if you're not walking in the Spirit, it's just good information. It's just stuff you can amen on Sunday morning. But it's not going to take have any real application to your life. Let's look at the scripture for just a moment. I want to show you just a couple of things today as we talk about why church ain't working. Why is church not working for some people? Come every Sunday, read my Bible, do Bible studies, Pastor Brian. I do some devotional. I pray, but my life is a mess. My life is a mess. I even put money in the offering. But my life is a mess. And the scripture actually speaks to this. Why is your marriage struggling? Why is your home messed up? Why are you so unhappy? Even though I know I get good teaching, I know I read my Bible, the Bible speaks to it. Look with me at Galatians chapter number 5. Galatians chapter number 5. Do you have your Bibles today? Do you have your Bibles today? By the way, one of the things that we are so excited about at our church is we make incremental progress. We're excited that our church is actually streaming live right now on the internet. So there are people last week, I think there were almost 70 people that joined our service remotely as we stream live over the internet, and we're excited about that. Amen. You ought to give the Lord a hand clap of praise for progress. Amen. Amen for progress. Do you have your Bibles today? If you have your Bibles, then lift up your Bibles and repeat after me. This is my Bible. It is the authoritative word of God. And when I practice its precepts, I can do what it says I can do. I can be what it says I can be. I am the head and not the tail. I am the victor and not the victim. And I walk by faith. And I walk by faith. One more time, Dean Hill, and I walk by faith. And not by sight. Amen. Praise the Lord. Galatians chapter number 5. Galatians chapter number 5. We don't ask that you stand to honor the preacher. We stand here as we honor God's word. I want to give you two passages today. And they all, by the way, they relate directly to Ephesians chapter number 5, which is the passage on marriage. In Ephesians chapter number 5, it says, don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. In Ephesians chapter number 5, before you even get to marriage, it says that we ought to walk in the Spirit. And so Galatians chapter number 5, verse number 16. Galatians chapter number 5, verse number 16. This I say then. You see it, Galatians 5, 16? This I say then, Paul writes to the church at Galatia, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Walk in the Spirit. But then look at John chapter number 6. This is Jesus speaking in John chapter number 6. Jesus speaking in John chapter number 6. John chapter number 6, verse number 63. John chapter number 6, verse number 63. If you have it, say amen. John 6, 63 says this. It is the spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profits what? The flesh profits nothing. Then Jesus goes on to say, the words that I speak unto you, they are what? It is the spirit that quickeneth, and flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak unto you are spirit, and they are life. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. The words that I speak unto you are spirit, and they are life. Walk in the spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Let us pray, and then ushers, you may have your rest. Precious God, our Father, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to take the paintbrush of the Holy Spirit and to paint on the canvas of our lives by your word. I pray, Lord, that as we study your word today, that you would enable us not only to see you in it, but to see us in it, to see how we operate as Christians, for us to judge and evaluate our own mindset, our own methods, our own way of doing things. Lord, are we truly yielding to you in every area of our lives? Or are we simply amening things and then continuing to do them the way we've always done? Are our minds being changed? Are our lives being transformed? Are we being led by your spirit? Are we humbling ourselves? Or are we simply doing just like the world does and believing that it pleases you that we just show up? Lord, help us to be led by the spirit, directed by the Spirit, that we might see true transformation in our lives. And Lord, help me to teach and preach in such a way today that brings you glory and honor. Not looking to offend, but sometimes your word is an offense. I pray, Lord, that you would encourage. I pray that you would equip. And then if you choose to, Lord, today, you can save a soul. And we'll be careful to give you all praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ushers, you may be seated. I had some phone problems this week. My wife knows that I ran into some problems with my phone. I had to take my phone and get it fixed. But one of the things that let me know that I had a problem with my phone was I picked up my phone and I looked at my phone, and my phone had that dreaded symbol that we see on it all the time. You know that symbol of the little battery on the phone, the little battery on the phone and the little plug-in that goes into the phone, and there's a picture of it on the first slide, and it's a picture of what I called a dead battery on my little iPhone. It was dead, and that's what I thought to myself. I looked at my phone and said, man, this phone is dead, and the Holy Spirit said, look at it again, and I looked at it, and I saw the little battery, and I saw the little symbol for the plug to plug in, and I said, my phone is dead, and the Holy Spirit said, look at it one more time, and I looked at it again, and I thought to myself, my phone is not dead. Because, see, if you can see the outline of the battery and you can see the little picture of the plug, that means your phone got power. Your phone has enough power to show you the battery. Your phone has enough power to show you the plug symbol. So the problem was not that my phone was dead. The problem was that my phone didn't have enough power to do anything. My phone was still alive at that point, but it just didn't have enough power to accomplish what a phone was supposed to accomplish. Why would I begin with that story? Because that is the way so many people live the Christian life. You ain't dead yet. But because you ain't been plugged in lately, you ain't got enough power to do what you're supposed to be able to do. We come to church every Sunday. We read Bibles. We do Bible studies. We got prayer partners. We on the phone with folks. But until you plug into the Holy Spirit, until you let the Holy Spirit lead, guide, and direct you, you will never have enough power. You are not a physical being hoping one day to live a spiritual life. You are a spiritual being right now. Right now, you are spirit. And God wants you to be led and directed by His Spirit. All the stuff we've been teaching, all the stuff about being a woman of God. You can get mad at me all you want to, but until you learn to yield to the Holy Spirit, you ain't gonna be a godly wife. Until you learn to yield to the Holy Spirit, you're not gonna be a godly husband. The words that we read to you are spirit, Jesus says. Spiritual words. And the only way they will take root in your life, the only way they will be real in your life, is if you realize that you are a spirit and you got to walk by the Spirit. And that is why more marriages are failing these days in the church than outside the church. Why is that, Pastor Brian? Because we operate in the same way people do outside the church. We operating without the Holy Spirit. We operating based on what we think and what we feel and what we like and what we don't like, when Christians are supposed to operate by the what?
Spirit.
By the Spirit. Amen. By the Holy Spirit. Ain't about what I want. It's not about what I like. It's not about what I feel. It's about, do I have the Holy Spirit of God living inside of me, speaking to me? And so, as we look at the passages today, I just want to encourage you today and tell you that church don't work without the Spirit. The sermon doesn't work without the Spirit. 5 points and a good message and a few stories don't work without the Spirit. It all has to be activated by the Holy Spirit. So point number one today. Point number one. Be genuine in your walk. Galatians 5:16 says, walk in the Spirit. 1 John 1:9 says that you need to walk in the light. We walk in the Spirit according to the Word of God. Look with me at 1 John, by the way. We're going to do a little Bible study today. Look with me at 1 John, way toward the back of the book. 1 John chapter 1. 1 James chapter 1. James chapter 1. I'm going to have you go into the wrong book. James chapter 1, verse 19. James chapter 1, verse 19. We'll get to 1 John in just a moment. James chapter 1, verse 19. Wherefore, my beloved, let every one of us be slow to speak, swift to hear, and slow to wrath. We need to walk in the Spirit and be quick to hear. Quick to hear, what does that mean? Listen to the Spirit. Be slow to speak. Don't react in the flesh. The only way you can hear the Holy Spirit is if you learn to be quiet sometimes. And don't respond to everything. Isn't it amazing how some of us call ourselves Christians, read our Bibles, pray, and every time somebody says something to us, we react in the flesh. Ain't nobody gonna talk to me like that. How dare you say something like that? Is that the Spirit? That's why it says be slow to speak. Sometimes let the Holy Spirit take over. Just don't say nothing. Walk in the Spirit means to live your life under the influence and under the power of the Holy Spirit, and be genuine in your walk. As I was telling the ministers, there are some people that really believe they're going to get to heaven by fooling the pastor. I'm going to convince y'all I'm something that I ain't. I'm going to dress up on Sunday. I'm going to put a smile on my face. I'm going to join the deacon board or the usher board or whatever other boards you got in the church. Sometimes that's why church don't work. We got too many boards. Operate under the Spirit and be genuine with God. Ask God to help you. If you ain't walking, some of us, let's just, when you get to be my age, I ain't gonna tell you how old I am, but when you get to be my age, sometimes you get so used to doing stuff your own way, God can't even tell you to do it different. And there are some people in our marriages, in the way we raise our children, in the way we treat our husbands or treat our wives, God can't even tell us nothing different because we want to do it our own way. But the only way you're going to be successful as a believer is to be genuine and be real with God and tell God, God, I ain't been walking under the influence of the Spirit, but God, I want to yield to you. I want to be slow to speak and I want to hear. I want to hear. And don't you, how many of y'all know that if you learn to listen to the Spirit, won't God guide you where you need to go? Won't God show you what you need to see?
Won't God bless you where you need to be blessed? Keep you from doing what you don't need to do. Every now and then somebody asks you to do something and you know ain't nothing wrong with it, but you hear a little voice on the inside say, that ain't for you, so you don't need to do that. Oh, but why ain't you gonna do it? Ain't nothing wrong with it. I know, but I hear the voice. I hear the Spirit speaking to me. Any of y'all ever had that feeling where the Holy Spirit just started talking to you about something and you said, I hear you and I want to walk in that? Every Sunday when you get the word of God, you know what's happening? The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. It ain't Pastor Brian's words. It ain't nothing that I'm making up or coming up with. It's from the word of God, and it's from the Holy Spirit to your spirit. Amen. And God just wants to know, does anybody out there hear me? Or as like they say, is this thing on? Do you hear me? Walk in the Spirit. I put this on one of the slides. Instead of saying, I'm human, I hate to hear Christians say that. God knows I'm only human. God knows I'm, if you were only human, you ain't saved. Because when you get saved, you become more than human. When you get saved now, you got the Holy Spirit living inside of you. If you were only human, God wouldn't expect you to do this. But once you become superhuman, once you become more than just a human, once you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you, stop using I'm only human as an excuse. And start using I'm saved as an excuse to walk in the Spirit. We use I'm human as an excuse to sin. Use I'm saved. Say that to yourself sometimes when stuff pop up in your life. I'm saved and I ain't doing that. I've been born again and I ain't going that direction. I've been delivered. Satan, you used to get me with that, but you ain't getting me with that anymore. Sometimes I look in the mirror and say, thank you, Jesus, because something that trapped me before didn't get me this time. I know I've been changed. Can I get a witness? Walk in the Spirit. God wants us to live spiritual lives. God wants us to have spiritual homes. God wants us to raise our children in a spiritual way. God wants us to have spiritual marriages. And if both people in the marriage are clinging to God instead of clinging to each other, clinging to God's word instead of clinging to, being led by the Spirit instead of being led by the flesh, that's when we see the home become what God would have it to be, walk in the Spirit. Stop listening to everybody else and start listening to me. We not only need to be for real about our walk, genuine about our walk, but we need to be governed by his word. Governed by his word. The Holy Spirit takes the word of God that you get on Sunday or when you're doing your Bible study or when you're reading. The Holy Spirit takes that word and activates it. Somebody say activate. The Holy Spirit activates the word of God in your life. In other words, he brings it back to your remembrance. He convicts and convinces you with it. You can be in the middle of an argument, in the middle of a situation, and because you got some word in you, the Holy Spirit will go and find that word and show you what you need to do based upon the word. That's why Jesus in John 6:63 said, the words that I give to you are spirit and they are life. And that word life is Zoe, Z-O-E, and that means the God-filled life, the godly life, the good life is what God wants you to have. But you only have that if you get some word in you. And guess what? If you ain't got no word in you, ain't none for the Holy Spirit to activate. You got to get some word in you. That's why we want you to study your Bible. That's why we tell you to read. That's why some people can't respond to something that the Spirit is trying to say to them, because ain't none to activate. You got to be genuine in your walk, and you have got to get God's word. Jesus said, my words are life. You need the word of God inside of you. Look at John 1, 6, and 7. 1 John 1, 6, and 7. 1 John 1, 6, and 7. 1 John 1, 6, and 7. Says this, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and we don't do the truth. But if we walk in the light, what's the light? The light is the revelation of God. The light is God's word. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship, listen to this, one with another.
And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. What does God want you to do? Be controlled by the Spirit. Get in your word so that you can get some light in you, and then you can walk in the light. You will no longer walk in darkness because now you have revelation in your life. I wouldn't know what it meant to be a godly husband if God didn't tell me. I wouldn't know what it meant to be a giver at church if God didn't tell me. I wouldn't know what it meant to pray if God didn't tell me. And I wouldn't know Jesus if God didn't tell me. But because I read it in his word, now the Holy Spirit brings it back to my remembrance. And can I tell you what it feel like? Let me take you back to some of y'all days before y'all got saved. Before y'all got saved, ever remember when you used to get in the car, turn on the radio, a song you ain't heard in years and years and years, comes on the radio, and all of a sudden you, there I go, back down memory lane. And you start remembering stuff that you hadn't thought about, relationships, situations, problems, things that you've been through, and you hadn't thought about it in forever. But because you heard that song, once you heard that song was in you. It wasn't activated, but it was in you. But then when you heard the first few lyrics of the song, that song got activated. And when the song got activated, you started thinking about all kinds of stuff associated with the song. That's what God does with the word in the life of a believer. When you get that word in you, and then someone even mentioned some part of the scripture, isn't it amazing how the Holy Spirit can bring that back and activate that? And now all of a sudden you start making decisions based upon a scripture that you ain't even thought about in a while. You start doing things based upon what the word of God says. And that's the Holy Spirit's job. When you walk in the Spirit, the word of God becomes life to you. And you start walking in that activated word in your life. But once again, you got to yield to the Spirit. You have to hear him. And James, and James says this. James says that we need to be doers of the word and not hearers of the word only, deceiving our own selves. Some people believe they spiritual and ain't spiritual at all. Why? Because I go to church. I go to a good Bible teaching church. I can quote a whole lot of scriptures, Pastor Brian. But until you start doing that word, that's when you become spiritual. You don't just hear the word. You do the word. You got to do what you have been taught. You got to do what the Holy Spirit shows you. That's when you grow, when you learn to walk by the Spirit, when you get in God's word, when the Holy Spirit activates that word, and then you are obedient to that word, and you start living your life according to the principles of the word. That's when your life changes. But if you want to hear it and don't want to do it, guess what James said? You're fooling yourself. If you are a hearer and not a doer, you are deceiving yourself. It's sort of like when I used to look in the mirror and just smile and say, man, you're a good looking fellow. Then I saw Denzel a couple times and started to realize what good looking looked like. I said, well, you're all right. The last thing you want to do is look in the mirror and be seeing something that ain't real. The last thing you want to do is be deceiving yourself. I'm a spiritual person, but I don't do my marriage the way God says. I don't give the way God says. I don't serve the way God says. I don't raise my children the way God says. But I carry around the Bible all the time, Pastor Brian, and I do a few Bible studies, Pastor Brian, and I pray with some people in the morning, Pastor Brian. That does not make you spiritual. That's just exercise. That's like the dude that I see all the time that gets up in the morning at 5 o'clock, puts on the workout clothes, gets in the car, drives to the gym, get to the gym, talk to folk, don't ever get on a machine, don't ever lift a weight, talk to folk for an hour and a half, and then 3 months later wonder why he ain't lost no weight. It look like you working out. It look like you going to the gym. But if you don't do that gym, ain't nothing gonna change. And if you don't do that word, ain't nothing gonna change. Somebody say, do that word. You got to do that word. Don't just hear that word, but get that word, get it in your life, and say, I'm going to do this word. I'm going to do what God has said. That's what changes you. That's what causes you to, I'm almost done already. Almost done already. You got to get the word inside of you. The words that I speak are life. Marvin Gaye said a long time ago, this ain't living. It's a whole lot of folk that's coming to church and wondering why they don't have the joy they used to have. But then we quote scriptures like, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me. World can't take it away. Then where your joy at? If the world didn't give it to you and the world can't take it away, where is it at? You ought to have some joy. Can I get a witness today? If you've been born again, if you've been saved and sanctified, if you've been delivered, you know who I'm like. I'm like the guy that drive by the prison, who was locked up for 15 years, but now he in the car driving by. And every time he look at the prison, he get happy, because that used to be him, but that ain't him no more. When you get saved, you ought to look back over your life. You don't need no preacher to make you happy. You don't need no sermon to make you happy. You don't need no song to make you happy. You got joy because God has already blessed you. God has already delivered you, and you're not going to get that joy until you get his word. There's freedom and release that comes from doing God's word. I was telling the preachers in the back, every now and then, I find myself looking in the mirror, and I find myself saying, thank you, God. For what, Pastor Bryant? Just that today was a decent day. Just that I didn't mess up that bad today. Anybody ever find yourself doing that? Just thank you for a good day, God. Thank you that what I used to do, I didn't fall into. Thank you, God, that person that I would have cussed out a few years ago, I just closed my eyes and prayed for him. Thank you that when that person cut me off in traffic, I would have followed him once upon a time. But now I just let him go, and I just waved my hand and said, it's going to be all right. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord, that I'm learning to walk in it. Baby steps. But I'm learning to walk in it. Your joy comes when you learn to walk in his word. I'm almost done, but let's finish. Be genuine about your walk. Be governed by his word. But then finally, be glad about his witness. Understand when you read the Bible who you are. Who you are. I'm just an old sinner operating under grace. No, you're not either. You've been transformed. You are a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. You ain't just been changed, you've been recreated. You are now a spiritual being in the image of God. And God wants to speak to you by his spirit if you've been saved. You've been transformed, born again, redeemed. You have to understand who you are and what you have. You know, when you get older, you repeat yourself, but I'm still young enough to know I'm repeating myself, so let me repeat myself. I like to tell a story of the man who won tickets on a cruise and first class accommodations on the cruise, but he was a poor man, didn't have a whole lot of money. So he had his ticket and he got on the cruise ship, and he didn't have any money for a whole lot, so he just packed himself a bag full of sandwiches because he knew the food was going to be expensive on the cruise. So he got a bag full of sandwiches, and for 7 days he would watch people dine at the captain's table. He would watch people eat the finest food. He would watch people have a great time, and he enjoyed the cruise okay, but he kept on eating them sandwiches because he didn't have money to afford all that food. And then finally, after eating sandwiches for 7 days on the cruise, after watching everybody eat, he was getting ready to get off the cruise, and the captain says, man, did you enjoy the cruise? He said, I would have, except for one thing. The captain said, what? He said, I got sick of my sandwiches. I didn't have enough money to afford that expensive food y'all sell, so I had to pack my sandwiches. And the captain looked at him and said, you don't understand, do you? Everything is included on the cruise. When you got the ticket, the food came with it. You've been living off of sandwiches when you didn't even know what you had. You had more than just sandwiches. And that's how some of us are as Christians. Realize who you are in Christ Jesus. You ain't in bondage no more. You ain't trapped no more. You've been set free. Sin should not reign in your life. The devil should not have control over you. You're somebody. You're a new creation. And guess what I love about being saved? Joy come with it. Peace come with it. Happiness. How you gonna be sad and be saved when happy come with being saved?
Happy is free. You ain't got to pay for it. Peace is free. You ain't got to pay for it. Joy come with it. You ain't got to pay for it. When you get Jesus, and that's why, you know what? I'd rather have Jesus than anything, because a whole lot of things come with Jesus. I'd rather have Jesus than anything. But when you get Jesus, you ain't just got Jesus. A whole lot come with it.
You are new, a new creation. If any man be in Christ, you're a new creation. You've been changed. As we close today, I want to show you how, in order to walk in the Spirit, you got to realize that you're a spiritual being. And if you don't, Pastor Brown, I'm saved. Pastor Brown, I hear what you're saying, but I don't feel free. I'm still doing the same stuff I used to do, Pastor Brown. It's not like I want to do it. But I am. But once again, that's because you do not realize yet that you got the power to overcome that. That's not who you are anymore. Look with me at Romans chapter number 8. Romans chapter number 8, New Testament. Romans chapter number 8. Romans chapter number 8. Closing passages today. Romans chapter number 8, verse number 13. Romans chapter number 8, verse number 13. And look at what it says. For if we live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. For as many as are led, as many as walk in the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again unto fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Now look at verse number 16. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. You know what I love about being saved? There's so many ways to get happy if you say. I can come to church, I can hear a song, and I can get happy. I thank God for church, I thank God for song. I can come to church and I can hear a sermon and I can get happy. I thank God for sermons and I thank God for songs. I thank God for conversations with other believers because I can get encouraged and I can get happy. But let me tell you the best thing about being saved. The best thing about being saved, I don't need none of that. First of all, I can thank myself happy. It ain't got to be nobody but me and Jesus. And I can thank myself happy. I can just start trying sometime. If you get a little down, just start saying thank you, Jesus. Just start lifting it, but Pastor Brian, I don't feel like it. Let me tell you something. It is easy to thank your way to a feeling than to feel your way to a thanking. Some of y'all gonna get that on the way home. It is easier to thank yourself to a feeling than to feel yourself to a thanking. In other words, you ain't gotta feel it. Thank him anyway. Hallelujah anyway. Thank you, Jesus, anyway. And what you know what you'll discover? I start feeling what I say after a while. At first, I didn't feel it, but something got a hold of me. All at once, something happened. I went to the meeting that night, and my soul wasn't right, but something got a hold of me. I can thank my way happy, but that ain't my favorite one. The scripture says his spirit bears witness with my spirit. I thank God for church and songs and sermons. I thank God for other believers and conversations. I thank God that I can thank my way happy. But as a Christian, I can think my way happy. I ain't got to say nothing. I can think my way happy. I can start having a spiritual conversation with the Holy Spirit inside of me. I can ask him, ain't God good? The Holy Spirit gonna say, you know he good. Hadn't God delivered? The Holy Spirit gonna say, you know God delivered. And you don't even, I'm just sitting there with a calm look on my face. But on the inside, his spirit is bearing witness with my spirit that God is good. You ever been sitting in the meeting? Ever been sitting in the cafeteria? And you say to yourself, I can't wait to get up out of this room. These folk gonna think I'm crazy if I do what I'm feeling right now. But as soon as I get out of here, I'ma thank the Lord because I done thought myself happy.
You can think yourself happy. And the Spirit bears witness with our spirit
God doesn't speak to your mind. God doesn't speak to your flesh. God is a spirit, and he bears witness to your spirit. He speaks to your spirit. And when he speaks to your spirit, how many of y'all know that's better than some messing with your flesh? That's better than folk trying to mess with your mind. Because from the heart reaches the heart, and from the spirit reaches the spirit. When God starts talking to your spirit, you can overcome your flesh. Your flesh may want to go this way, but I'm in a spiritual conversation now. I'm in a spiritual relationship. And my spiritual relationship is with God. Are you walking in the spirit? Are you in God's word? And then taking that word and applying it to your life so that you can live out the principles of scripture, not just to do what the preacher said, but so that you can have joy, so that you can have zoe, so that you can have the God-filled life. He wants you to walk in the spirit. As we close today, I got some homework for you. Some homework for you today. Three things I want to leave you with. Three things I want to leave you with as we close. Number one, honestly ask yourself, if you're a person who consistently walks in the spirit, and be for real about it. If your marriage ain't right, is it because of the other person? Or do you have a lot to do with it too? It's because you ain't doing what God said. I'm going to wait until the children are in children's church one Sunday. And I'm going to teach some of y'all what the Bible says about marital relations. And how it ain't, you don't even belong to you no more. You belong to your spouse when you, it's a whole lot that come with marriage too. You belong to the other person now. And it's a lot of y'all spend a whole lot of time claiming you're spiritual, claiming you're obeying God, claiming you want your marriage to be everything that God wants it to be, but you won't do what you know to do. You won't obey in the areas that you don't like. And you wonder why you don't have joy. So are you consistently walking in the spirit, in your marriage, in your finances, in your home? Honestly, ask yourself that question. And then number two, after you ask yourself the question, go back. Don't take the preacher's word for it. Read. Look at Romans chapter number 8 and read that chapter. Look at Ephesians chapter number 5 and read from the beginning. Not just what it says about husbands and wives, but what it says about how you ought to be filled in the spirit and singing psalms and spiritual songs and hymns and making melodies to God. And then go back and read Galatians chapter number 5. And how it says that you ought to walk in the spirit. Are you consistently walking in the spirit? Are you willing to look at the passages that talk about walking in the spirit and obeying the spirit? And then finally, pray. Pray and ask God to help you. You've been honest about it. You got the information that you need. Now pray and ask God to help you to walk in the spirit. Because as Marvin Gaye said, this ain't living. It ain't living going to church wondering why church ain't working. It ain't living going to church wondering why you carrying a big heavy Bible. Some of y'all got them real big Bibles too. I call them big sanctified Bibles. Some of y'all got them Bibles. Oh, wait, Pastor Brian, you got one. Yeah, one of these. But it does no good if you won't apply what's on the inside. Honestly, pray. Be genuine about your walk. Go get you some word and do that word. Be governed by his word. And then finally, remember and realize who you are. You shouldn't be living that way if you're saved. Your children shouldn't see you doing certain things. Husbands and wives shouldn't treat each other certain ways in front of their children. If you're saved, remember who you are. That's who you used to be. That's not who you are right now. You're a new creation. And let his spirit bear witness to your spirit that you are now the sons and daughters of God. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. If there's nothing else, let us pray. Let's pray. Praise God, our Father. One of my favorite sayings, and the reason why I love it so much is because it makes me laugh every time I hear it. And I love a good joke. But one of my favorite things that I like to hear church people say is, time is out for playing church. And I always laugh because my first thought is, when was time in for playing church? Church doesn't work because we don't understand what church is. This is where we get information for application. But this is not where the transformation takes place necessarily. The transformation has already happened. And so what we do, Lord, is we get good information. We get good teaching. And then we take it and we apply it. We let the Holy Spirit activate the word in our lives, and we see the fruit of that in our lives. And if we read Galatians chapter number 5, it talks about what the fruit of the Spirit are. Joy, peace, happiness. But the one is love. Love is the primary fruit. Lord, I pray for those under the sound of my voice today, especially for those believers that are tiptoeing around the whole subject of holiness, tiptoeing around the whole subject of obedience, getting mad at somebody else because you ain't willing to do what you know God would have you to do. And instead of looking at yourself in the mirror, you're always looking at somebody else, saying, look, he ain't right, and he won't do this, and he won't do that. And being not willing to admit, no, it's me, oh Lord. It's me. I'm the one that is not living out my salvation. And the reason why I'm so bitter and unhappy, the reason why I'm angry, is because I ain't doing what I'm supposed to do. Give me my joy back, God. Give me my peace back. And help me to walk by whatever it takes, God. Give me that strength to push my flesh to the side, to push what I hear on talk shows and even what I hear other believers that are married, that in my spirit, the spirit keep telling me that ain't right. Help me to push that aside and to just hear your voice. Be quick to hear, slow to speak, quick to obey. Lord, I pray for us as believers. I pray that churches would be filling stations where people come when they're low on fuel and where they get the word put in the tank. But even then, they still got to go somewhere and turn the key so that it can be activated in their lives. And the key is to do it. I pray for this church. I pray for every church, Lord. And then I pray for our marriages. I pray for our homes. I pray for our children, Lord. Many times in 2017, children are so pragmatic. They're so realistic. And the reason why a lot of our babies aren't getting saved is because they don't see no act of faith in our lives. They see church stuff, church clothes and church cars and church smiles on our faces and church hallelujahs and church waving our hands. But behind the scenes, they don't see spirit activated, spirit led, humbled lives. Help us to be broken over our own sin, not mad at somebody else about theirs. Help us to be for real with you. And then, Lord, help us to actually ask ourselves, is the spirit in me? Do I have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of me? Is there an indwelling? Because if I don't have the Spirit, I'm none of His. But if you don't have Him, the good news is He's available. If you're sitting under the sound of my voice right now and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I told you a lot of stuff come with that. And the best thing that comes with that is the Holy Spirit. He gets inside of you. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, if you believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you can be saved today. So maybe all of this, all of the talking, all the singing, all the service was about you. Maybe it was about God reaching out to you. If you don't know Him today, will you come? Just come on. Come on and get saved. Come on and get your joy. Come on and get your peace. Come on and get your happiness. In other words, come on and get your Jesus. He wants you. He's available to you. If you don't know Him today, will you come? He died for you. And if you're willing to confess that, He will save your soul today. Just come on. Walk in faith. Take a step of faith today. If you don't know Him, take a step of faith today. If you trust Him, take a step of faith today. Don't do what your flesh says. Don't do what your mind says. Because if you're getting saved, even now the Spirit is working on you. And then maybe there's somebody on the sound of my voice, you say that you know the Lord, but you need a church home. You need to be taught. You need to have better understanding. You've lived your whole life as a Christian, and you're not even really sure what that means. You know you love Jesus. You know you've accepted Him, but you believe that there's more. There's more. There's a depth that you don't get. Such as we have, we offer it to you. Just come if you're looking for a church home. Come if you want to learn. Come if you want to grow. And then now for the altar call today. We offer people to come if they don't know Christ. We offer people to come if they don't have a church home, and we ask that you stand to my left. But then if you're here today and you want to be led by the Spirit, you're a believer, but you want to walk in the Spirit. If you believe that God has more for you, if you want to go where you've never gone before, if you believe that there's something out there for you and you want to hear from God and you want to start to walk in His Spirit and listen to His Spirit, just come to the altar today. Just come to the altar. Maybe there's ministry. Maybe God wants you to invest deeper in your own Christian education. Maybe God wants you to repent of something, be released from something, be delivered from something. Just join us at the altar. Let's pray about it together. Because in my spirit, I feel a stirring. In my spirit, I feel like there's more for me. Somebody else may feel that way too. I feel like God's getting ready to do something with me. And it's bigger than what I'm doing now. It's more than what I'm doing now. If that's you, will you come? Will you come? The first step is obedience. The first step is obedience. Join us at the altar today. Let's do this quickly. Make up your mind if you're going to come, and come on, let's do this quickly. Just come on. Come on. Let the Spirit lead you. Come on. Come on. If you feel Him, come on. If you want Him, if you know He wants you to come, just come on. And Lord, it wouldn't matter to me if I was standing up here all by myself, because I know that you got something for me. Something for me to do. I'm not looking for blessings. I'm not looking for wealth. I'm not looking for increase. Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit. I want to just walk in the Spirit and obey you. I want to not be governed by fear or what people think. I don't want to be governed by attitudes. I don't want to be governed by tradition. I don't want to be held back worrying about what folk going to say about me or what people going to think about me. I just want to launch out, God. I want to launch out into the deep and see what you have. If that's you today, just come. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Clap of praise. We have a couple of young ladies that have come today. And I'm assuming that you're coming because you believe God has more for you to do. Tell us why you... Let me hear from you rather than make an assumption. Tell me why you've come today.
I do believe that God has more for me to do. And I've accepted that, and me and Jesus, we can talk about it every day. But I'm not here for that.
Come on, sister.
I'm here to lay my doors on this altar right now. What have they done? No more than no other young folks. But the point of the matter is our young children are in a world of trouble just like we all are. And like I was saying earlier in my prayer, they want to skip steps or be something they're not. And I raised them up purposely in church to know that God has Jesus is the answer to every problem that you can ever have. He is. I know this because I tried Him for myself, so I decided to just bring my children, my daughter, here to lay them on the altar, because I know that this altar works. I know that this altar works. I know if you lay your problems down and leave them here, that He'll pick them up. I know that He, because He's healed me, He keep on keeping me in spite of me. So if I didn't believe, I wouldn't be up here saying this. If I didn't love them, I wouldn't be up here telling y'all this. And I just really want to know if there's any other mothers or parents that would want to come up here and stand in the gap for their child right now. If you can't come up here at the altar, just stand where you are right now. Because our children are in trouble. And just for an example, Elena can come up, can do whatever, y'all. It's smart when it comes to getting, organizing things and doing things. But when it comes to doing what she's supposed to do, there's a problem. And I know she's not the only young girl that does this.
I know that if it was, if she was the first one acting up like this, then I would be ashamed. But I'm not ashamed to tell y'all. Can do everything else. But when it comes to doing what you're supposed to do, then when mama tell you, you don't even want to listen to what mama's saying. But anybody out there in the street can come along and tell you and have you spending your whole check on what they talking about. So I'm going to lay Elena down at this altar, ladies, if y'all don't mind. And Alex, selfishness. You're in a marriage now. What you say, your body, not even yours anymore. The word of God. Yes. Nothing that Pastor Anthony Bryan just made up. This was the word of God today. Yes. And sometimes when people hear other people's problems, they think, well, Eveline did something, this. Well, I just told you, me and Jesus talk every day, yes, all day. And sometimes he'll attack our children,
yes,
Shay,
he will.
When I decide to walk in his way.
Yeah.
He'll attack the ones around me that's too weak.
Yeah.
It ain't my fault.
Mm-mm.
I did everything I could, Miss Party.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still praying for him.
Mm-hmm. Come on now.
But I'm not going to abide by what they talking about.
Yeah.
I'm going to abide by his word.
Come on now.
I'm going to go on.
Come on now.
I'm going to shut my mouth, Pastor, and keep on praying.
On.
I'm not going to get on their level.
Yeah.
I'm not going to cuss them out.
Yeah.
I'm going to pray and go and give them to Jesus.
Yeah.
They not going to come up in my household with it.
Come on now.
I know him.
Yeah.
He showed me who he is.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to do those things I used to do no more.
Yeah, yeah.
And guess what? I feel all right about
come
it.
Come on now.
I feel all right about it. I don't feel guilty. I used to feel guilty when I was trying to do what they was doing, Malia. I love them too much. I'm not going to love them the wrong way no more, Pastor. I'm loving the way the word of God says. Quick thing, and I'm going to give Malia the mic. Just like I noticed a parent working for the city of South Haven, a police case came out of Horn Lake. These children were doing something they had no business doing. The mother helping them, got the gun for them and helping them. I don't love my children that way, because I'm going to call the police on them. I just want to know, if y'all don't mind, can I lay my children at this altar? Because I know for a fact that he will. Sonya, he promised me.
Yeah.
Huh, what we seen yesterday? Jesus promised he'll take care of me.
Yeah.
Glory to God. Thank you.
Coming after that, I feel like I really don't need the mic anymore. But I came up here because I know Jesus, and I know that he is my Savior. I know, like her, I talk to him all the time. But I act like I don't. I mean, I'm in a new position as an owner, Corby and I, and, you know, when words get back to me that people are talking, and I'm like, that's not true. But why do I react at those things? If I know it, all I have to do is please God, and the rest will fall in line. And I've started looking at it this past week after talking to Pastor and Tammy, and like, why am I worried about that? Do I know what I did? God knows what I did, and he's my provider. He's my everything. So I just pray that I can start realizing that sooner before I speak or before I react, that I'm slow to speak and I don't engage in any of that as a woman of God. And that's all I have to worry with. And that's it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have a few brothers here. I was going to say I'm surrounded by some sisters, but I see a couple of brothers here today. Well, listen, there was a specific call out for mothers. And, of course, husbands, you can stand with your wives if you so choose. Men, if you're under the sound of my voice and you want to come up here and be with your spouse today, we're going to pray for our young people. I think what Sister Benson said is so applicable to all of us. We think we know our children, but sometimes we don't really know our children the way we think we know our children. Because the world will attack us, attack our children. And sometimes our children just aren't mature enough. Sometimes we aren't either, to withstand the attacks of the enemy. So we need to pray for our children. And I used to always pray this prayer for myself: Lord, you hold me till I get sense enough to do what's right. You block my opportunity. to do wrong, Lord, because I know I'm not strong enough right now. But, Lord, I know that you can stop it. You can block it. And that's what we pray for our children, Lord. Cut it off. Remove people from their lives that are bad influences. Remove situations, Lord. Lord, I know you can do that. Sister Shepherd, do you mind praying for the ladies today? Are you okay? No, you ain't gonna do it. I'm not going to ask you. I didn't see you back there. All right. This is what I'm going to pray today. I'm going to pray today. Men, will you join us at the altar? Men, if you want to join us at the altar, will you join us at the altar? Amen. Just come on. Come on. Come on. Sister Bryant, will you join us at the altar? I know you got the baby. I'm going to take the baby, and you're going to pray today. That's what the Holy Spirit just told me to do. Amen. Come on.
We thank you. We just thank you for being brave and just coming out and just stepping out on faith, knowing that God is going to hear and answer your prayers. All of us as mothers, we deal with things. We deal with our children disobeying, but God always reminds people that you used to be there, you used to be just like them. You used to disobey as well. But us as mothers and fathers, we have to continue to pray for our children. Like she said, they are under attack. And if we're not encouraging them in our homes, don't you all know that the street will? And yesterday, Tyree was up in Memphis. It's only by the grace of God that he didn't get, he got his car broken into. It could have been another way. I remember being around his age, getting robbed, walking from school, had a gun put to my head. But see, they just stole his things and his items. And so I'm grateful for that. And I thank God for keeping him in run on yesterday. Because it could have been another way. But Lord, I thank you for keeping my children. And as a mother, we love our children. And our kids don't understand us when we get on them, but we only want what's best for them. We only want what's best for them. Let us bow. Father God, we just come before you this morning, thanking you for your grace. God, thanking you for your mercy. Just thanking you for being God all by yourself, Lord Jesus. God, we thank you for our children. God, they may not be all that we want them to be, but like sister said, God, we're laying all of our children at the altar on today. Lord, knowing that you're going to do your work in them, God. Knowing that you're going to save them in due time, God. Knowing that you're going to use them as your vessels, Lord. God, all our children have a calling on their lives, God. But help them to tap into it like Pastor said on today, Lord. We need to walk in the Spirit. God, help our children to walk in the Spirit. Lord, we know that it's hard for them. Lord, temptation is, Lord, it comes up against all of us, God. But you said if we resist the devil, he will flee from us, God. And so help our children resist the devil, and he will flee from them, God. God, we know that our children all are going to be all that you have called them to be, God. Because you said in your word that we must walk in the Spirit, and we must walk in the calling that you have placed on our lives, God. And so, Lord, we thank you for our babies, God. Continue to encourage them, God. Lord, we ask that you help us as mothers and fathers to encourage our children, God. Instead of tearing them down, Lord, help us to build them up, God. God, because they're being torn down on Instagram, Facebook, and all over the place, God. But when they come home, God, help us to encourage them. Tell them, I love you, baby, no matter what you've done, God. And Lord, help us to continue to just keep them in our prayers daily, Lord. God, we just thank you, Lord. We praise you for what you're going to do in our children's lives, God. And Lord, we pray for all of our college students, God, that you will just bless them, God. Help them to stay focused, God, on what they're there to do, God. God, it's not on the boys and it's not on the girls, but God, they have a work on their lives, God. God, they have a career that they're going after them after, Lord, and help them to stay focused, God. Lord, we just thank you and we praise you, Lord. God, you've been good to us, God. Lord, we just ask that you will continue to bless all the kids, Lord, that's headed back to school, God. School is coming up soon. God, and I pray for their teachers, God. Lord, that you will give them godly teachers, God, before they even hit those classrooms, God. God, we ask that you would just bless them with godly teachers, God. And we thank you, Lord. Keep our children safe, Lord. Bless our children in a mighty way. Use our children in a mighty way, God. God, we know you can and we know you will, Lord. You're able to do all things, God. All things, God, are possible with you, God. All things, God. And Lord, I pray for my sister, Malia, Lord. I continue to ask you to continue to bless her, God. Whatever she's dealing with, God, I ask that you will just help her and give her direction and give her vision, God. Because, God, I know it's not easy being, Lord, just an owner of a salon, God. And I know that she has all kinds of things coming up against her. But, Lord, help her to walk in the spirit, like Pastor said. And everything will be all right, God. And help her to continue to pray and have faith that you will work it out, God. Lord, we love you. We praise you. And this we pray in your darling son. And we say amen, amen, and thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Amen. We thank God for the individuals that came down for prayer. We thank God for you for praying with us. And the time for prayer is not just on Sunday morning. We need to be praying. I love the way Sister Benson says she talks to Jesus every day because we need him every day. And so we need to just continue to pray for each other, pray for our children, and then pray for our walks and our relationship with the Lord. At this time, the officers of the church are going to come. They're going to very quickly raise our offering. Immediately after that, our announcements will come. I do have one special announcement as the officers come. We are doing children's church teachers training today immediately after service. If you have received that invitation, if you know that you're going to be teaching in our upcoming children's church sessions, please come to the training today. We've put together some good information for you. You'll get your uniforms today as we train you on what the expectations are. We have a lot of new teachers that are coming forth to teach. We gave some new people invitations to teach, so we look forward to meeting with you today. That's immediately after service. It'll be in the room over here to our right behind the curtain, what we call the choir room. So we'll meet in there immediately after service. Let's give the Lord one more hand clap of praise. And I turn you over to the hand of our capable officer.
Today was a much-needed day for me. I'd like to take back to my family and make myself better. Thank you for that message, Pat. Truly needed. All right, to the outside, we have the tithes and offerings inside, missionary. Also have one more announcement. Pastor Abe, I'm sorry. Have one more announcement for Mail Corps Day, July 16th. We want all y'all to come out and participate in Oak Grove Celebration. St. Mary, New Prospect, have confirmed that they will be attending, so I want you all to come out and enjoy the day. We're now in the hands of the earth.
Father, we thank you for blessing us, and thank you for allowing us to be able to come back and give back to you on this day, Lord. We know that every good and perfect gift comes from you. Lord, we pray that you would teach us to be better stewards of all that we have, and that everything that was given today would be used in a way that pleases you. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you and amen. Now we will have our announcements from our announcing secretary. Please give her a hand as she comes.
Good afternoon. You're celebrating a birthday today or this week. Would you please stand? Kira, is that you? Okay. We wish you a happy birthday, and may the Lord bless you with many more. You're celebrating an anniversary today or this week. Would you please stand? The following is a list of our weekly announcements. Donut fundraiser sheets are due today to Sister Dolores Cox. There will be a mandatory Children's Church teachers meeting today after service. If you are interested in teaching, you are welcome to attend the meeting and see Sister Shepherd or myself as well if you have questions or concerns. Mail Course Day will be here next Sunday at 2:30 p.m. We are collecting items for a back-to-school drive through August the 4th. There is a box in the foyer to place your items. College scholarships and acceptance letters are due to me no later than August 6th. There will not be any accepted after August 6th. First annual gospel musical Explosion will be Saturday, September 16th, 7 p.m. The tickets are on sale now for $15 in advance. They will be $20 at the door. Please see Sister Shaquana Jones or Sister Wanda Jones to purchase one. Our church picnic will be Saturday, July 29th, 2017, starting at 10 o'clock a.m. We welcome you to have fun, to fellowship, and have some good eating. All right, our thought for the week, God loved us first so we can love others. Any necessary corrections or additions will come from our pastor.
Amen. Come on one more time and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. I am blessed and honored to go to a church where there are so many gifted and talented people. And in the back earlier this morning, Reverend Partee brought some interesting information, and he was telling us that in this nation, there are so many churches in America that for every 500 or so people, there's a church. And a church in a nation of hundreds of millions of people, there are so many churches in the United States that there's a church for every 500 people in the United States. But then he was talking about how yet our culture and our society continues to go down. How we see trends and changes in our society that are negative and are opposite the word and will of God. Is the issue that these churches aren't teaching? Is the issue that the pastor aren't preaching? Is the issue that the Bible is an outdated book and is not relevant in 2017? Oh no, none of those things are true. Until the church, until the members of the church, until the body of Christ needs to understand that we are spiritual beings. And if we don't learn to listen to and walk according to the Spirit of God, we won't see change in our lives, much less in society. Amen. We won't see changes in our homes, much less in society. We won't see changes in our marriages. Somebody told me all the time, marriage is hard. Yes, marriage is hard. I'll say it with you, marriage is hard. But is anything hard for God? Is the question from the passage. There's nothing hard for God. And so when we yield to God, when we do it God's way, when we let God come in and control us by his Spirit, that's when we begin to see growth and change. That's when we begin to see joy and happiness. That's when we begin to see evangelism and growth and ministry and service, when we learn to walk according to the Spirit. And until that, of course, the flesh is going to have its way, because we can't do this by flesh. It's not by might. It's by my Spirit, says the Lord. So I just pray for you. I pray for me. I pray for all of us that we would learn to, Galatians 5:16, walk in the Spirit so we do not fulfill the desires of the flesh. If there's nothing else, give the Lord one more hand clap of praise. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your participation. Thank you for your prayers. At this time, we're getting ready to go. Can we all stand? Can we all stand? Why don't you do this with me today? Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can. Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can. One more time. Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can. Precious God, our Father, you have equipped and empowered us with all that we need to be difference makers, to be life changers, to change not only our lives, but to change the lives of our children. You've given us all that we need. But Lord, now we need to give you us. Lord, I pray right now that you would enable us to give ourselves back to you. Some of us have lost the meaning of faith. Some of us believe that faith is about us. It's about what we want. It's about how we feel. It's about what we want to do. It's about my future, my path, my direction, my joy, my happiness. When faith is not even about me. It's about you. Faith is about, Lord, what do you want me to do? Faith is about, Lord, what do you require of me? Faith is about, Lord, what do you want me to give up? What do you want me to sacrifice? What do you want me to leave alone? What do you want me to leave behind? What do you want me to walk away from? Lord, here's my offering. And so, Lord, I will offer you my hopes. I will offer you my dreams. I will offer you my desires. I will offer you my flesh. I give all that to you because of all that you've given to me. And Lord, I give you control. I take my hand off the wheel. And I say, drive, Holy Spirit. Show me where you want me to go. By your word, Lord, your word is the road. Your Holy Spirit is the driver. Now, Lord, take me where you want me to go. Your word is the light and the lamp. And the Holy Spirit is he who communicates to my spirit your desires. Lord, help us be that kind of church. Help us have those kind of households. Transform our marriages to be those kind of marriages. Help our children to see that in us. And then, Lord, help us go take it to the world that we've been changed and that the same one that changed us can change you as well. Lord, I pray for this church that there would be ministry in this church, that we would start to operate according to your spirit in this church and go out there and tell somebody and bring them in here. And once we bring them, learn to love them when they come in here. Learn to teach them and trust you, God. Lord, we say all the time at this church, and for some of us, we just have to admit we're not being truthful when we say we walk by faith and not by sight. When some of us, all we do is operate based on what we see. Now help us, Lord, to close our eyes and to rely on your spirit and to walk by faith the way that we claim. To be led, Lord, by faith in your word, led by faith in your teaching, led by faith in your example, led by faith in your spirit. We don't have to see the outcome, Lord, to know that it's going to be good. Because if I do what you say, it's going to be good. As I heard a young lady say earlier today, let us learn to praise you not based on what we see, but what we haven't seen yet. Let us say thank you based on what we haven't even seen yet. Because we know, Lord, all things work together for our good. Bless us as we leave this place, but not from your presence. Lord, thank you for every senior citizen, every visitor today. Thank you for our motherboard today. Thank you for our musicians that accompanied our choir today. Thank you for our choir and those that led songs today, Lord, because they minister to our soul and to our spirit. We thank you, Lord, for everything that our eyes have seen, our ears have heard. We thank you, Lord, for every member of this church, for the deacons and for the ushers and for the greeters and for the audiovisual team and for all those that make this church a service, Lord. We thank you for the security personnel that are out there sweating on the parking lot, Lord. We thank you for them, Lord. But Lord, after we've done thanking you for everybody else, we save the best praise for Jesus. We thank you for Jesus. He's the one that saved us and changed us. We used to say this all the time, if it wasn't for the Lord, where would I be? Thank you for Jesus. Lord, bless our members. Bless the young ladies that came down for choir, for prayer. Lord, bless our young people. Bless our families. And then, Lord, as we leave this place but not from your presence, we say, Lord, to you who are able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of your glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both henceforth and forevermore. And the people of God said together, amen, 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 and amen. God bless you and God keep you as our prayer. Have a great week this week. You're dismissed in the name of our Lord.